Hi, my name is Tina Swithin, author of Divorcing a Narcissist and founder of One Mom's Battle, which is an online resource for individuals enduring custody battles with personality disordered individuals, such as narcissists, borderlines, and antisocial, which is, we refer to commonly as sociopaths. You know, I did not wind up on this road on purpose. I often refer to myself as the accidental advocate. I never chose this path. It was one that was truly chosen for me. I do believe that. And while my own personal custody battle ended in 2014, you know, is it ever really over? Until my children are 18 and have aged out of the system, I believe I am still in the battle. My battle has now morphed into a different journey, and that is one of being an advocate for mainly moms, but also I have some dads that I do walk alongside. And, you know, I hold their hand in the family court system, and that takes form in a variety of ways. Sometimes it's through phone consultations, and other times I donate and do a lot of pro bono work in the courtrooms by just sitting there with them as they go through this journey of their own to protect their children. My message today is really aimed towards mental health professionals. I'm absolutely grateful that on my journey, I had the fortune of having very qualified, knowledgeable mental health professionals on my team. It wasn't always the case, but the ones who really stuck by my daughters and I and guided us and helped us along the way, you know, they truly understood what we were up against in family court. I think that is a rare thing, unfortunately. What I find is that unless a mental health professional has personally experienced a narcissist or a sociopath or a borderline, either in their own lives or truly walked hand in hand with a victim of one of these individuals, they don't really get it. And a lot of my clients are actually mental health professionals. They will all tell me the same thing. You know, they all say, Tina, you can't learn this in school. You can't learn this in textbooks or in a lecture. This is truly something that until you've lived it, you really don't get what this is about. And when I say what this is about, I'm specifically talking about cluster B personality disorders and child custody situations. These individuals can be so charming and so charismatic. They are actors, and some are actresses, to where they really have spent their lives watching how people react and how to manipulate people and how to win in whatever capacity they are facing in that moment. I have watched them turn on the waterworks in court. My own husband, ex-husband, was a pro at that. But what this is truly about for them is winning, and it's about control. Most cluster B individuals have a need to control everyone around them. I often say they can walk into a room and scan the entire crowd and figure out pretty quickly what is in it for them as it relates to each person in that room. And it could be a status, you know, it could be someone who they can ladder climb with. It could be that they want to impress the sister of one of the people in the room. It's really, from a clinical perspective, it would be fascinating to watch. and fascinating to study. But when you are in the trenches trying to protect your children from one of these individuals, it is like a living nightmare. And so, you know, I feel that mental health professionals could use a tremendous amount of education on the inner workings of Cluster B personality disorders, even more important, what it means in a custody battle. And during their marriage, they had such a need for control. I know that was the case in my marriage, and everyone that I talked to had the same type of experience. And so when the marriage ends, regardless of who pulled the trigger and ended the marriage, they feel a loss of control with their ex-spouse. And so their new avenue of abuse becomes the family court system and the children. Everyone who I've met through this journey, regardless of what side of the fence they're on, can agree that the family court system is broken. You know, there are a variety of answers to how we go about fixing it. Everybody seems to have a different opinion. A lot of it is based on their own personal experience. But one of the main components that I personally feel needs to be fixed in the family court system truly comes down to mental health professionals. These are the people that the judges are putting so much weight into their opinions and the reports that are created through custody evaluations or through co-parenting sessions or mediation. And so the lack of education within the mental health community is a huge part of our problem. And until they understand what it is like to divorce a narcissist or other Cluster B person, things are not going to change. And, you know, one of the things that I personally struggled with is court-appointed mental health professionals who automatically labeled me as a, you know, jilted mom who, you know, just wanted to get back at my ex-husband. I found that the mentality in the system is you married this guy and he can't be that bad. You chose to have children with him, and so you need to walk this out and co-parent with him. The reality is these people are very charming. I will own my part of the equation for ending up in this situation, but now it's no longer about me. It's about protecting my kids from someone where I've seen behind the mask, I've seen behind the curtain, I know what is back there, and it has nothing to do with me being jilted or jealous of his new life or relationship. You know, none of that comes into play. I want more than anything to co-parent with someone who is healthy and who is truly putting my children first. But the reality is these individuals are absolutely not capable of putting children first. In the beginning of my custody battle, I remember a situation where my ex-husband kept going back into my daughter's bedroom to say goodnight to her. And I couldn't figure out why he was doing that. He was on his way out. We were currently in a nesting agreement. He kept going back into her bedroom and telling her how much he was going to miss her and how sad he was going to be without her. And she just, every time he'd go in there, she kept escalating and crying harder, and he would just go back in and make it all worse again. And I could not understand for the life of me what was happening and why he was doing this. And when I went into my daughter's room to try to de-escalate the situation, I noticed that he had a video camera set up on the floor, and he was trying to get her escalated so he could capture on video how sad she was when he was leaving the room or leaving for the week. And that was such a pivotal moment for me because I realized how truly sick he was, that he would hurt my daughters just to hurt me and just to win in the family court system. That was an eye-opening day for me and terrifying because my daughter was 2 years old, and the trauma that she has endured over the years at his hands while the family court system was trying to figure it out, will be unpacking that baggage for the rest of her life. As a mom or as a healthy parent, it's heartbreaking to watch. You know what is going on, and you're so desperate for the courts and the family court, the mental health professionals to understand. But in that, you end up looking like the unstable one, because no healthy individual can believe that someone who presents as so charming and so charismatic could really do this to a child. But my case is not isolated. This is happening, this and worse, all over the place. I had talked to another mom years ago who, every time her ex-husband would return her infant, the baby would scream and cry whenever it had to go back to her. It made no sense because she had such a strong attachment to this child. They ended up setting up a video camera in the driveway. And what they did, they captured him putting a small thumbtack device on his finger so that when he went to hand the baby off to mom, he would poke the baby on the thigh and it would cause tremendous amount of pain, but it was such a small pinprick that no one could see any physical ailments on the child. This is an individual who also presented very well in the courtroom, by all accounts, three-piece suit, very successful, could turn on the waterworks in court and pretend to be just this compassionate, loving dad who was being excluded from his children's lives. It is like dealing with a Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. I used to say to the judge, this person who's sitting next to me in the courtroom, I don't even know who this is. Because when I walk out of these courtroom doors and the spotlight is off of him, I am dealing with a completely different person. I would love to co-parent with this person who you are seeing in front of you, but that is not who I am co-parenting with. There is just so much to cover on this topic. Another thing that I wanted to get across is if you are a mental health professional and you are helping someone to navigate this, or you're providing co-parenting counseling for an individual or for a set of individuals, or if you are supervising a child custody situation, please know that the parent who is firm on following the court order, it's not because they are rigid and unbending and that they like conflict. They have worked so hard to get that court order in place, and that is their boundary. And the healing that they have done along the way, it's critical for them to keep their boundaries in place. I remember when my daughters started supervised visits in 2014, and this was with a marriage and family therapist here in my area in San Luis Obispo, California. And my daughters were just absolutely distraught going into these visits. And I was reporting to the supervisor, my daughter missed school for anxiety. She's having extreme stomach pain. And everything I was saying was being dismissed. She's fine. They need a relationship with their dad, no matter how dysfunctional he is, on and on and on. And I knew I was walking a very fine line because if I really went up against this person, it was going to affect my custody case. So I had to try my best to articulate what was going on without offending her or pushing her buttons. And, when she was trying to deviate from our court order, I had to try to explain to her that this is an individual who has no respect for my boundaries, absolutely none. And I have worked for 6 years to get this court order to where it protects me, and that is my boundary. And so her coming in and asking me to deviate from that, you know, it didn't mean that I was rigid and unwilling to compromise. It meant that I put so much value in that judge's order, which is a court order. It's law. You know, I abide by the law. Silly me. You know, but I was baffled when she wanted me to deviate from that. And I did my best to explain to her that that was my boundary and I had worked very hard for that. Did it still make an impact on her? Not really. You know, she really did not get it. 2 years ago, my ex-husband's brother was arrested as the biggest child molester pedophile in the history of our county. And reaching out to her now, and I had the opportunity recently to sit down with her and talk about my experience and how I felt that, you know, not only was she not validating my reality, but she was asking me to bury it and not acknowledging what my children had been through our custody battle and how triggering it was for them to sit with their dad. You know, because my case has media attention and is well known locally, you know, now she gets it. Now she understands what I was fighting for and fighting against. But back then, all she saw was a 6 foot tall, blonde hair, blue eyed, you know, guy in a 3-piece suit who presented very well and accused me of alienation and gatekeeping. You know, I feel like we now have one more educated family court professional in my area, but it should not be this difficult to protect a child. Family court professionals need to understand who Cluster B personalities are and how they affect children. They do not have the capacity to love a child the way you and I could. And in fact, all they see is a pawn in this war. And that is, you know, I hope the takeaway is pay attention to words and actions. And if they are not in alignment, that should be a huge red flag. If someone is sitting in your office pouring out their sob story about how they've, you know, been so hurt by the system and separated from their children, make sure that you're reading the background on the case and what the accusations are. And it can take a while to weed through all of that, but every single child that is in this system is counting on you as an educated mental health professional to protect their children. And I beg you to do that, because I feel very fortunate that I did have a group along the way who did get it, or at least wanted to and worked to understand, but most don't. And, you know, the system needs you to be a voice and an advocate for these children. So I invite you to read my journey, One Mom's Battle, Divorcing a Narcissist. And if you are a mental health professional and you haven't yet read my book, reach out to me. I will offer it to you at a discount, at my cost. My email address is tina@tinaswithin.com. And that's T-I-N-A Swithin, S-W-I-T-H-I-N.com. Thank you so much for joining me today. I hope you're subscribed to our One Mom's Battle YouTube channel, where we share tips and strategies for parents who are enduring custody battles in the family court system. Thank you so much.